fact, well, I won't talk about the topic because many of these colonial personages are alleged to have a spectral presence in various haunted houses in Calcutta. So I will leave it to the speaker to talk about that. Just to say that this is the second lecture that Professor Tapati Guha-Thakurta is giving us in the series titled The Object Shows of Empire. We had the first one last Tuesday. And these lectures are enabled by a very generous gift donation from the Ahuja Family Fellowships program at the South Asian Institute at Columbia University, and we have been extremely grateful to the Ahuja family. Sanjeev, Anju, and Sudhji are here, so welcome. And thank you once more on behalf of the South Asian Institute. I will hand you over to Professor Vidya Dehejia, the Barbara Stoller Miller Professor of South Asian Art here at Columbia, who will introduce our speaker tonight.
I'm delighted to have this opportunity to welcome and to introduce Tapati Guha-Thakurta, who by now probably doesn't need any introduction. But the few of you who may not have attended all the other sessions that she's been giving, she is, of course, the director of the Center for Studies in Social Sciences in Calcutta, where she is also professor of history. She's almost entirely a Calcutta product, except that she did her DPhil at Oxford, moved to Oxford, and worked on her dissertation, which was later published under the title The Making of a New Indian Art, Artists, Aesthetics, and Nationalism in Bengal, circa 1850 to 1920. It is a handbook that anyone in the art history department anywhere uses all the time. Another very important book of hers, which is always on my reading list, is one that I'm really happy to say was published by Columbia University Press. And it's called Monuments, Objects, Histories, Institutions of Art in Colonial and Postcolonial India. She has edited, co-edited a number of books. One, for instance, Theorizing the Present, Essays for Partho Chatterjee, and another co-edited book called New Cultural Histories of India, Materiality and Practices. Her most recent book is one titled In the Name of the Goddess, The Durga Pujas of Contemporary Calcutta. And if I remember rightly, Tapati, one of the talks that you gave for us at the South Asia Institute, maybe as much as 12 years ago, was on the Durga Puja when you were just starting that project.
2004.
It does seem years ago.
One of the first,
when you were just starting to work on the Durga Pujas and talking about Durga Pujas. I do have a little, tiny little story to tell you before I hand it over to Tapati. At the time that I was at the Freer and Sackler Galleries in Washington, D.C. as their chief curator, etc., etc., I was organizing an exhibition called Devi the Great Goddess. And Tapati agreed to write an essay for the catalog. It's a big, huge catalog of that size. And her essay was titled Clothing the Goddess. The catalog had to go to press. And there was one footnote in Tapati's essay that for some reason was missing its page numbers. And the editor at the Freer Sackler was getting very antsy about this. It had to go into press this week, and where was this footnote? So I said, no problem, she's got it there, she'll send it to me. sent her a on Monday morning I sent her an email, Tuesday I sent her an email, Wednesday I tried to call her, Thursday I sent her an email, Friday I sent her an email. Finally, on Monday morning, my email had sprung to life. There was the footnote, and with it, here was the note that she attached. I could imagine the tone of her voice. It said, "Lydia, you of all people, it's been Durga Puja and Calcutta closes down." Anyway, she's not going to be talking about a book that she's finished. Instead, as we all know, she's talking about a current project, and she's going to be talking to us today about Calcutta's colonial and post-colonial statuary, what's happening with it. Please join me in welcoming Tapati Guha-Thakurta.
Vidya reminded me of many times in which I've either delayed or let her down with different articles that we do. But that time I think I have a justification for once. But that was a long time ago. So thank you very much. It's a pleasure being here again. I thank those of you who've heard too much of me over the past few days for turning up again. So it's been a packed week, but as Patila said, it's also Halloween. Nonetheless, this is about ghostly figures, sure, but nothing as fun as Halloween is out on the streets. Okay, so, just briefly, think about the title with which I'm thinking perhaps of something like a book that may come about, but still in its very formative stage, which would think about empire, and particularly so it would be a 19th and 20th century history, maybe beginning with the 18th century, because my talk earlier this week took us back to figures like Hindu Stewart, who are really 18th century figures, and moving on into the end of empire and the post-colonial period. And I wanted particularly to think about how we may think of both outward and inward flows of objects, but think about spheres of material transactions through which we may revisit again the encounter with empire. So that's broadly the theme. The work on statues is something I must say I began a fairly long time ago, but then it never moved. The Durga Puja book had to be finished first. And then, of course, I found there were connected histories between the two, something I'll come to somewhere in the paper, and it is largely, I'm hoping now, to take up the project again, but looking at it much more in terms of the materiality of the form of the statue. So, yes, and again, like the last talk I gave, the locus is Calcutta. So yes, as I explained, my work has been very Calcutta-centered, but I'm hoping, as we discussed in the last class, to make Calcutta the kind of cosmos to think outwards with. And it's not a bad place to begin, or even to end up in, if you're in my stage of life. Okay. What we've come to think of the modern urban civic statue as a broadly generic form, reproducing itself through cities across the globe. I'd invite you in this lecture today to reflect on the way each city, large or small, European or Indian, presents its own distinctive landscape, history, and politics of statuary. My focus in this talk is on the city of Calcutta and on the specific history of the shifting caste and sites of its colonial and post-colonial statues over the 19th and 20th centuries. Now, some of this cast may not be fully familiar to this audience, but I will not dwell too much on the figures who become statues. So in some sense, my main concern with the study is less about the galaxy of great men and only occasionally women who get to become statues, or about where and by whose demands these statues come to be erected. This has been the main thrust of much of the recent work in India on the past and present symbolic politics of statue making and also statue desecrations. Statues and busts, as these studies show, have been at the crux of the turbulent identity politics of caste, language, and ethnicities of post-independence India. They seem to play a critical, persistent role, not only in the official rituals of commemoration and veneration, but equally in the claims over public spaces and assertion of rights of various marginalized or contending communities, especially in the contemporary representational politics of Dalits across Indian cities. So in some ways, I found that working on statues, Dalit politics and the kind of study on cultural politics of Dalit identities provides one lead into thinking about statues because they've been absolutely central to that politics. But what struck me was that neither in art history nor really those studying India's imperial and nationalist histories have ever thought very much about statues as a lens through which to think about these histories. However, as I said, in this paper, veering away from the line of analysis of the politics and political lives of statuary, which is, there's been a fair amount of work on that, I'd like to today pose a parallel set of questions about the form and materiality of these objects and about the work of representation and embodiment that they perform. So the theme of death and animation is central to my concern and about kind of spectral identities and of embodiment that happens through the genre of figuration. And I'm also interested in recovery, the stories of travels, transfers, and relocations that lie behind these apparently immovable figures. Now, there's a long quotation by Robert Wilson, an off-cited one, on monuments, which I'm putting up there. And I am not going to read out the quotation, it will be up there. And yes, the italics are my emphasis. We try a little harder, and they do not, it seems, comprehend our age of noise and movement. Now, a lot of work on monuments and statues have continuously returned to this classic piece by Robert Wilson. Now, I cite this set of observations by Robert Musil to think not just about what I will call the invisibility of much of public statuary, but equally about the recalcitrance of this genre in remaining outside the fray of India's popular visual cultures to show how this form of figurative statuary occupies a place of continuing disinterest within the field of art history and visual studies. Compared to the seductive visual charge of other popular iconographies in the contemporary image-saturated landscape of our cities, this corpus of civic statues stand curiously emptied of animation and affect, springing to public attention only through the brief moments of their consecration or through passing spectacular acts of their vandalization and destruction, as routinely occurs with various sectarian and dissenting identity politics across different parts of India. In a recent work on the competing politics of monumental religious and Dalit statuary in contemporary North India, Kajri Jain moves away from the trajectory of Robert Musil's pronouncements on the fate of monumental statuary in city spaces to argue that the kinds of giant sculpted figures she's studying are indeed trying harder to keep up with their times in the city, to fight oblivion and hegemonize the visual and sensory landscapes of the sites of their inhabitation. My study of the shifting sculptural iconography of colonial and postcolonial Calcutta will pull in different directions to ask a somewhat different set of questions. Why is it that the commemorative purpose of these figures routinely exceed their representational or mimetic functions? And what are the difficulties that stand in the way of our sustained emotional and affective engagement with these public objects? Now, the first section is called Between Commemoration and Oblivion, and I'll be taking you through a rather rapid journey through Calcutta's landscape, and the journey will be as one drives by, so it will be that kind of a jerky journey, and I'll not be dwelling too much on them. The more these statues surround us in our cityscape, the less we tend to see them. As sentinels, they appear to silently watch over us more than we ever stop to watch them. We pass them by in every stumble and turn in our travels through a city like Calcutta, either as larger-than-life figures encased in marble and bronze, perched high on their pedestals, in prominent avenues, crossings, and roundabouts, sometimes in railed-off parks laid out to house them, or often as smaller plaster busts standing on commemorative plaques in neighborhood street sides and corners, hardly distinguishable among trees, traffic, and roadside clutter. There's a routine disfamiliarity in the appearance of these sculpted figures and heads in these street settings that divest them of any active visual interest and place them within a ready set of iconographic parameters of a public personality. This is particularly true of the two iconic figures that proliferate Calcutta's statue landscape, those of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose and Swami Vivekananda. Okay, so as I said, these are the two figures which proliferate Calcutta's statue landscape, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose and Swami Vivekananda. They're everywhere, large and small, to glut one's vision in every part of the city, each stuck in a set pose, one with his monastic robes and turban, the other sometimes identifiable by his Congress cap, the other time by his military uniform. Alongside are also to be seen a spurt of busts of Indira and Rajiv Gandhi that particularly came up after the assassination in 1984 and 1991. These figures imperceptibly blending with many other heads scattered in public spots that often call out for us to read their plaques and find out who they may be. So this was one of the surprises I found while wandering around Esplanade, a rare bust of a marginalized leader killed in an encounter, now clearly raised by public subscription. There's another kind of surprise that awaits us in other locations in the city. When the bronze figure of the bespectacled and suited scientist, the physicist Vedanath Shah, suddenly springs to notice in a street island at the crossing of Southern Avenue in an apologetic reminder that the street is now named after him, which otherwise nobody really knows. Or when we look up above the auto rickshaws and crowds of the Taliganj metro station and find there Calcutta's movie icon, Uttam Kumar, to remind us again of the new naming of this metro station after this matinee idol. There's frequently an utter sense of despondence and neglect in which these statues stand steeped, as with this figure of Sir Ashutosh Mukherjee, judge of the Calcutta High Court, first VC of Calcutta University, at the entrance to Central Avenue. This was not only the earliest full-figure statue of an Indian notable to find its place on the city streets, but also the first public work of the Bengali academic sculptor Devi Prasad Raichaudhuri. But today it's barely recognizable as it stands above banners with even the name erased from the plinth. And then there are the rows of nationalist leaders we speedily drive by in the stretch from the Victoria Memorial past the greens of the Maidan onto the thick traffic of Esplanade and Dalhousie Square, figures standing as mute replacements of the imperial peers. A stiffly swaddled Rishi Aurobindo, occupying the place of the statue of Lord Curzon, ironically even the same pedestal, turning his back pointedly on the Victoria Memorial. The revolutionary Jyotindranath Mukhopadhyay, locally called Bagha Jyoti, awkwardly straddled on a horse, which I'm sure he never rode, to somehow keep pace with the many imposing equestrian figures of British governor generals and viceroys. Or we have a marching flag-carrying Matungini Hazra, a local lady, a woman leader of the Quit India movement in Bindapur, Now, this is Matukmini Hajra before she falls to the police bullet in 1942, said to be Calcutta's first monumental female nationalist statue to rival in sheer bulk the many Queen Victorias that had come up at the turn of the 20th century. Calcuttans have responded to these post-colonial street sentinels, often with more mockery than reverence, with a repeated refrain about the failure of our nationalist statuary to ever match up to the pomp and finesse of their colonial counterparts. Benedict Anderson uses the quotation of Robert Milson, which I cited, to reflect on what he sees as the specific, I quote, commemorational difficulties and imaginative impasse of all late official nationalisms. We could extend this argument to think about the similar impasse and representational vacuity that spill over into the sculptural memorials that post-colonial nation states have obsessively produced in mimicry of their colonial predecessors. The paradoxical status of these objects are intensified by the way this representational genre has kept proliferating across official and non-official sites as the continuing chosen form of memorialization of public persons. Popular disinterest has far from halted or even substantially altered the thriving career of this genre of civic statuary. How may we trace, then, the continuing efficacy of this form of figurative human sculpture as a repeating template of public monuments and memorials in a city like Calcutta, where the genre of statuary stands caught in a particular historical bind of the blending of India's colonial and post-colonial histories? And this would be true for many other Indian cities too. These giant public statues of rulers of the empire, initially made mainly in marble, with the preference later shifting to bronze castings, were among the most monumental and widely traveling objects of British India, and is the widely traveling aspect which came more as a discovery on how much materials and objects traveled across this length. One, because statues were almost invariably made in England and then traveled a long distance to be installed here. So these are among the most monumental and widely traveling objects of British India, with Calcutta and London operating as the two central depots of orders and supplies. Through the 19th and early 20th century, these statues, commissioned from India and largely financed by public subscriptions raised by committees set up in India, were made in stone sculpting studios or bronze foundries in England and laboriously transported to India for installation at a designated memorial site, with 7 years elapsing between the time of the commissioning and the final arrival and erection of these statues in different cities of the empire. There were instances as with this famous, it's meant to be one of John Henry Foley's best equestrian work, the statue of General Outram of the Mutiny, now standing in Victoria Memorial Grounds. Following the commission given to John Henry Foley in 1861 by a combined London and Calcutta committee, the government of India had to send across to London 11 tons of gunmetal for the casting of the figure, the finished form of which was transported to Calcutta 13 years later and ceremonially unveiled in 1874. So think of the number of years that elapsed and the kinds of transfers of material. As cultural commodities, these statues thus contain within them elaborate and prolonged material histories of production, transactions, and travels, linking the metropolitan and colonial topographies of the memorialization of imperial power. Within the colony, these monumental objects can be seen to continually change locations and occupy new sites of display and attention. This was especially the case when the city's grand monument of the Victoria Memorial was completed in 1921, and several statues that seem an integral part of the building and its grounds today actually moved there from their prior locations around the town hall or around the Park Street Chorlami Junction. This was the instance, for instance, with this statue of Lord Cornwallis, as we said, the first. What's also interesting is that it's clearly a ready-made copy of a Roman imperial figure on which we have the head of Cornwallis literally added on. And you can see the line around the neck to see how you would take these bodies of Roman emperors and put their heads on there. So this was their ways in which Convolus here stages his appearance as a Roman emperor with even an olive branch. And you have other cases too of, say, a bending figure, which it's a very bad old photograph, which is in the town hall location and which is later relocated to the Victoria Memorial, and you have a wonderful sati frieze beneath. Because remember, Bentinck was instrumental in the abolition of sati. Okay. Two decades after the end of empire, the politically turbulent decade of the 1960s in Calcutta brought with it a more dramatic spate of dislodging, replacements, and relocations of statues across different spaces of the city. And this is what I'm hoping will be the subject of a longer study, which is the postcolonial story of statue building and replacements. It was in a sudden short sweep between 1967 and 69, during the regime of the first United Front government in West Bengal, that all statues of colonial rulers were programmatically removed of the city streets by the Public Works Department and transported to the grounds of the Flagstaff House in the nearby cantonment town of Barrackpore. Much restored here, used to be a complete town, this place, leaving untouched the large group that stood near the Victoria Memorial grounds. Never destroyed or vandalized, as were many of the colonial statuary in Bombay in the 1950s and the violence attending the state formation of Maharashtra. I could not find, I have these images of Victoria with their face blasted off, which are all behind the Bhaugaji Lal Museum now. Couldn't find them on my computer here. But unlike that, Calcutta's statues, it seems, were carefully rehoused, first kept in the lawns here, and later under Viren Shah, the governor, and Gopal Krishna Gandhi particularly, were carefully rehoused around the neoclassical war cenotaph that we see here, and set up on new brick pedestals on the lawns of Flagstaff House, the equestrian and standing statues neatly laid out in coordinated groups on two sides of the ground. So it's actually a very carefully curated space now. Over the 1970s, in the midst of the city, in a strange musical chair game of substitution, a series of Indian nationalist leaders began to take their stands in the spots emptied of the colonial masters. In 1970, Deshubandhu Chittaranjan Das came up in an island where an equestrian Lord Canning had stood for 90 years before he was banished to the riverbanks at Barrackpore to keep company with the ornate tombstone of his wife, who was buried there. In 1972, a sculpture of the young revolutionary martyr of Bengal, Khudiram Bose, replaced Lord Auckland on the same plinth at the junction of the State Assembly House, with the Auckland statue traveling all the way to the city named after him in New Zealand. And in 1976, the figure of another Bengal revolutionary, Shuji Shen, the leader of the Chittagong Armory Raid of 1930, took Lord Northbrook's place amongst the Gothic majesty of the Calcutta High Court, among the plinth are the names of all the people who died in the Armory Raid. This is when the nationalist statue mania that took off during the 1940s from its 19th century colonial precedence reached its post-colonial peak. This is also when this quintessentially colonial genre figurative sculpture found itself continuously contending with its domesticated career as a local representational and commemorative practice. And as I said, I hope in a larger work that I'm planning to take up the circuit of movement, circulations, and substitutions that have been central to the changing production and landscape of Calcutta's civic statue. I turn to the next section, which is called On Materiality and Objecthood, where we're focusing more closely on the logic of form and materiality, on specifically the notion of the dead object, on the sense of the inert and inanimate that seems to be embedded in the very nature of these massive figural statuary that render them monumental on the very terms that empties them of all semblances of life and movement. It becomes pertinent to reflect here on the theme of death and the process of the metamorphosis of the dead person into a life-size three-dimensional figure. All the more because although many of the colonial statuary of governors, governor generals, and viceroys were commissioned and erected in their lifetimes, almost never coinciding though with their tenure in the empire, and very often by the time they arrived, many of them were no longer living, we find all latter-day statuary of Indian nationalist leaders and public personalities coming up primarily in the aftermath of their death. And here as an aside, Mayawati has broken that idea. I mean, she was one of those figures who decided to make a living ruler a statue. And I think it's a first time, but there may be more. I'm waiting for a Mamata statue to come out soon in Bengal. But I've been working though in the earlier period when you needed to be dead to become a statue. The assumption is at work that it is only a person who ceased to exist whose anthropomorphic likeness can most appositely and effectively be rendered into a commemorative sculpted object. So if you think of how the Oxford English Dictionary defines a statue, one, a representation in the round of a living being sculpted, molded, or cast in metal, plaster, or light material. And two, a type of silence or absence of movement or feeling. One of the central paradoxes, I argue, lies in the way these constitutive elements of freezing and stillness, the absence of movement and feeling, results in the draining of life and affect from figures which are made to embody presence and personhood, whereby public statues become literally and metaphorically as dead as the humans they represent and substitute. From this follows another set of constraints and conundrums. Despite their largeness and privileged locations, these public statues, as we've seen, frequently end up as the least visible and most ignored objects of urban spectatorship, as they find themselves consigned to a liminal status. I should just go back to an image to keep it there. As they find themselves consigned to a liminal status of being neither art nor icons, lacking in either sufficient aesthetic or affective appeal, of belonging to neither high nor popular culture. These public statues, even the ones sculpted with greatest finesse and representational similitude, exist more as imposing objects than as affective images, functioning more as markers of places than of persons. Let us think then of how the factor of the material that goes into the production and form of the statues on the one hand, and the factor of the place it is made to occupy on the other, makes for a particular trajectory of presence and personhood in the genre of marble, bronze, or plaster statuary, and holds it apart from the kinds of animation that the human likeness exudes within other realist visual genres, like the portrait photograph, for instance, or the wax model in a museum. It is instructive to contrast our statuary with these two other mimetic representational forms, ones most readily associated with the exact simulations of living persons, to see how the transference of presence from person to the image operates very differently in each of these. Much has been written on the extent to which the intensely affective quality of a photographed face revolves around both the iconic and indexical quality of the chemically reproduced image on processed paper, about how the photograph becomes most efficacious as the trace of the real, as the staging of an absent presence, as the visual preservation of personhood beyond death. And of course, Roland Barthes' Camera Lucida remains the most moving testimony to this part of the photograph. Now, the photograph of the dead person assumes its special charge in local sculpting studios such as these, when it is often from a small photographic image that the statue maker is made to recreate an imagined persuasive likeness, giving special attention to matters of hairstyle, accessories, and attire. Also placing it within the format of the bust or the full figure. Now, this is a statue maker whose career I would like to follow more, who takes these tiny photographs of ordinary people and reproduces them either as busts or even as full-seated figures and images. And all he has to work out from is the photograph. But when the family tells him about postures, possible poses they would like. And it made me realize how ordinary people also, you know, often they're not marble or bronze, they're plaster statues that are commissioned. But making a dead person into a statue is an important move of commemoration. Okay. The nature of the sculpting material, whether it be layers of clay and plaster, and a lot of the Kumatuli people continue to work with the inner casing of clay. So clay remains a medium of sculpting. Intervened centrally in this process of mimesis, whereby the tactile field of human flesh and drapes of clothing gets transplanted into the mass language of metal, stone, or plaster. When it comes to great leaders, the pose of the painted or photographed figure must be transferred into a set of formal sculptural conventions of pompous gesticulating postures, like of Sharad Bose lifting his finger, or stances of deep and frozen contemplation, like we see in the figure on the right. Ordinary clothing must give way to official and ceremonial costumes. Critical here are the effects, especially of voluminous masses of drapery in transforming the human anatomy into an abstracted and monumental object, whether it be the enormous spreading robes of a seated Victoria that dramatically make up her regal bulk, this is the most famous statue of Victoria in front of the memorial, or whether they be the flowing folds of dhotis of nationalist leaders, as can be seen in the statue of Ishwar Bhujitanatundas. From the beginning of its history into recent times, this genre of public statuary has followed two conventional methods of sculpture making, either carving, modeling, and chiseling from the outside, as with figures made out of blocks of marble, granite, or sandstone, or casting from the inside out, as with models made of clay, plaster, wax, or fiber, where a negative inner mold may be deployed to cast a positive replica in molten metal like bronze. The latter technique contains the possibility of an actual human head and body serving as the core from which a clay or plaster mold may be taken and layered upon. While this has been an experimental practice with contemporary sculptors who often use their own and others' bodies as corpographs caked in plaster, this was also the basis of an earlier practice of making death masks from the faces of corpses and served as the core technique out of which Madame Tussaud perfected her art of making exact wax models of the dead and the living. In a wax modeling career that began in France in the late 18th century at the height of the revolution and reign of terror, Madame Tussaud's models were first born out of casts taken directly from dead bodies and guillotine heads before she graduated to other modes of replicating exact likenesses of her subject. So Mara dead in his bath, she was actually made to take a death mask from the dead figure itself. This is where wax models took on the aura of holy effigies and reliquaries of medieval saints, carrying in them the trace of the original persons. And Marina Bona has an excellent essay on this, thinking about how the career of Madame Tussaud goes back to the period of when both medical anatomical models but also wax effigies are being made, so the secular and the sacred worlds of image making come together. This is also where modern sculpture wishes, as W.J.T. Mitchell writes in his famous essay, What Do Sculptures Want? This is where wax model, oh, this is also where modern sculpture wishes not just for a place to be, but to be a place itself, a place where someone has lived. This is Mitchell's words. Can the kinds of marble or bronze statuary we are concerned with ever play out a similar desire to function as such a trace or place of the once living? Can we really think of the hard and passive exteriors as hiding a soft, animate core within? Or does the intractable materiality of their medium and form make the surface all important and release the object of any further performative requirement of simulating life and movement. There's a striking contrast to be drawn here between the forms of animation in life-sized wax models, the closest popular equivalent of this form of figural sculpture, one which has followed a similar technique as bronze or plaster statuary or being cast from the inside out. Even as it has moved far from its earlier modes of cast making from real heads and bodies, wax models, we know, have continued to work with actual organic substances like hair, eyelashes, especially articles of clothing. So we know Michael Jackson's actual clothing and eyelashes go into wax models. And wax is a substance with its natural glistening surface and its ability to hold light within itself has also been ideally suited to recreating the softness and luminosity of flesh. All in all, wax models epitomize, in Marina Warner's words, the simulacrum's quest for authenticity. Flesh colored and fully clothed, they invite beholders to override the actual fakery and engage with them in their mysterious fullness of life. In a museum that remains one of the most popular attractions of Britain and now is a global institution with centers all over the world, these wax models serve their main purpose in allowing crowds to mingle and mix with them in close quarters and play their best tricks in letting the originals pose with their doubles, challenging us to separate the real from the copy. So this we know that all Madame Tussaud models have their real figures posing with the model. They carry with them the full charge of the Pygmalion syndrome, the sensual desire of dead matter turning into living form, the quality of the uncanny wherein the inert sculpted likeness seems likely at any point of stirring to life. It is precisely this kind of mimetic figures that could have met Robert Mrs. Devon, that they turn, tap their feet, or at least blink their eyes. But never the still and somber marble and bronze public figures that stand sentinel in streets, parks, high aloof from their pedestals, or within spaces like the Victoria Memorial. It could be argued that these statues hold their own by stubbornly refusing to succumb to the popular demands for animation and simulation of a living being. At their haughtiest, this genre of figural sculpture would zealously cling to its superior aesthetic status and its affinities with the canonical Western traditions of classical and neoclassical sculpture, and look askance at the many cheap popular variants of this genre that went into the making of shop mannequins or lifelike wax models. Even as this Western genre has over the years bred a spreading tribe of local practitioners and found its way into the practices of several local sculpture-making studios, there's been an unchanging investment in keeping going the material and formal conventions, the looks, poses, and medium of this style of realist statuary. The avoidance, even abhorrence, of lifelike coloring marks out the particularities of this commemorative form and finds its articulation even among the workmen of small sculpture studios that operate within the vicinities of the city's main idol-making hub at Kumutui, where from the mid-20th century, there were many from traditional clay modeling families, who acquired art school training and diversified into the parallel practice and livelihood of commissioned statue making. So this is where the two parts of my work connect. The adding on of colors and clothes in their view are associated with the sculpting of clay idols, a form they feel needs to be kept strictly apart from realist figural sculptures and are seen to be properties of the devotional or worshipped icon. By contrast, pristine white is seen to bring gravity, dignity, and its own quality of sacrality to the sculpted figures of great men and women and is regarded as the most appropriate color for civic statuary. So whether made in the cheap medium of plaster, which we see here, or the new durable lightweight medium of fiberglass, these sculptures are given a white coloring and the look of marble, which is what we see here in this group where we have saints, Derozio, Rani Rashmani, all crowding the same space. Same form spills over into this figure of a patriarch who his descendants wish to immortalize as a statue, or say in this lineup of plaster statuary where you have both real life saints and Lord Shiva being put up for sale on top of a Kumudpuri studio, but interestingly all white. The value of whiteness is parallel by a similar premium on pure black. And this is coming out of the fact that the many bronze cast officially commissioned statues of nationalist public personalities of the post-independence decade, where one is not really able to afford bronze or keep up the patina, so instead you have them painted a bronze color or painted black, or now even often a bilious green, which is meant to be looking like copper or bronze with a patina. Now this thick painting over, particularly this almost tarring over, has been a way of covering over stains and bird droppings over these figures and circuiting the expense and expertise required for the professional cleaning of bronze services. What this has showed up is the contrasting appearance of the colonial period standing and equestrian bronze sculptures in the Victoria Memorial or the Barrackpore grounds, which have retained their more carefully treated and gray patinas alongside their greater flourish and intricacies of sculpted form. Black paint, on the other hand, has led to the even greater massification and dehumanization of the figures or much of the latter-day Indian statuary, and have allowed the sheer monumental volume to displace the demands of verisimilitude and personhood. And as sure as contrast occurs in Ansel Ramon Ram, which is a classic instance of this massive black tarring. Standing atop their conical pedestal, set against the light at different times of the day, these statues typically inhabit our cityscape as dark and abstracted silhouettes. An outsized, outstretched arm marking out Netaji's call of his march to Delhi. Massive flag and the trademark walking stick marking out a Matrungini Hazra and a Gandhi. And football shorts and bare striking feet marking the figure of the Mohan Bagan club hero Oshtubihari Pal on the Maidan. Their placements high above eye level in crowded locations and avenues meant mainly for moving traffic makes close viewing impossible, and even photographing details of faces, gestures and accessories a challenge. W.J.T. Mitchell tells us of sculpture's deep longing for a place and ideal locus. These statues can be seen to have slipped from such a desire for a place to become places in themselves, functioning more effectively as landmarks of city locations than as figural representations and likenesses. This section is called Statuing on Sculptures, where I wish to explore the crucial distinction between the two categories, a distinction of quality, aesthetic, style, and function, both to think about how it sifts out the fine art of colonial statuary from its lesser proliferating post-colonial variants within the city, but also to reflect upon the terms of the local appropriation of the colonial genre that mark its passage from official art into popular kitsch. In what ways, we could ask, do statues fall short of being sculpture? And when and in what context can they move from one nomenclature to the other? Okay. Now, a new wave of historical and aesthetic attention has been turned in recent years on what is termed as Britain's National School of Figurative Realist Sculpture and on its thriving career in the history of British imperialism. London by the early 19th century is shown to emerge as, I quote, the sculptural capital of the world, and evolve as a special hub of sculptural cosmopolitanism in the long Victorian era, with the constant influx of the best of continental sculptors, especially from Italy and France. It is within this environment that the period's neoclassical schools of marble and bronze sculpture blended into the making of a triumphalist imperial sculptural iconography to meet the commemorative demands of the colonies. Calcutta's long cast of marble and bronze imperial men can be placed within these detailed histories of sculptural commissions and productions that move between the colony and the metropolis, charting the transition from the early preponderance of marble and neoclassical allegorical styles, of which this Richard Westmacott piece on Warren Hastings is one of the best examples, to the later premium on realist gigantic bronze casting. Practically each item of Calcutta's colonial period statuary have now acquired an individuated identity as an artwork associated with the studio and style of a known sculptor of the period, with the names of artists and foundries engraved at the pedestal to be searched out from the body of the sculpture itself. Among this repertoire, we have, for instance, this piece, Richard Westmacott's 1828 marble sculptural group of Warren Hastings, which I showed in my last lecture as an example of an orientalist tableau, which had moved to the Victoria Memorial in 1921 from its prior location at the portico of the town hall. Or we have the grand equestrian figures of Lord Hardinge on the right and General Outram on the left, erected in 1859 and 1874 as the finest examples of the work of the mid-19th century sculptor John Henry Foley. We also have a spate of young and old Queen Victoria's in Calcutta, commissioned in different periods of her reign and in the aftermath of her death by Matthew Noble, Thomas Brock, and this is the George Frampton piece, which I've shown earlier. From the earliest marble statue of Lord Cornwallis in Roman costume, sculpted in 2003 by Thomas Banks, which we saw earlier, to the last imperial bronze of Emperor George V, made in 1938 by the Scottish sculptor William Macmillan, Calcutta's colonial statues can be situated within a changing history of techniques and stylistic conventions of the British School of Figurative Sculpture. Ironically, it is now in the quiet repose of their post-colonial locations, in the serenity of the Barrack Poor Flagstaff House, also in the enclosed picturesque gardens of the Victoria Memorial, that these statues make themselves available for the close and specialized study of their sculptural form. In the one site, the Barrack Poor Flagstaff House, they are open to viewing only by select groups of dignitaries, visitors, and scholars by special appointment with the Calcutta Rajbhavan. In the other site, they are used primarily as backgrounds for snapshots or seating spots for courting couples. So the Foley statue is now tucked away at the furthest end of the Victoria Memorial. And finding it was very hard. And when I did find it, I was clearly not a very welcome presence among the couples who were sitting around there. Emptied of the personhood of the colonial rulers, these statues, I would argue, have made their unintended transition into becoming works of sculpture. At the same time, they continue to have their affective resonances. So we find ourselves drawn to the solitary figure of Lord Canning on his horseback, now located on the riverbank of Bellport, keeping watch over his wife's tomb on the same location. Even as local residents pull us away towards a reverse nationalist history of Indian martyrdom in this cantonment town, where a sculpted bust on a noose marks the site of under the banyan tree of the hanging of the sepoy Mangal Pandey during the uprising of 1857. So if you go around asking for where Lord Canning is, nobody can really tell you, but they know where the Mangal Pandey Udyan is. And this is where it is. It was in the secluded intimacy of this Barrack Poor residence that West Bengal's previous governor, Gopal Krishna Gandhi, who was really responsible for restoring the statues in that location, decided to launch his witty conversations with the 12 large statues on the grounds, whom he considered to be, I quote, really speaking, the house's only true residents. Admiring the Greek godlike marble body, waving hair, and perfectly made boots of the young Captain William Peel, he wondered why fate made this handsome youth die not a hero's death on the battlefield, but of the dreaded Indian disease of smallpox. or looking at the water stains on the patina of the head of Emperor George V, now brought to an eye level on the steps of the cenotaph, he sympathized with his majesty perspiring beneath the burden of his crown and heavy robes. And as Gandhi's grandson, he had pondered how the launch of the first non-cooperation movement must have squeezed out the pomp and thrown into deep worry this unusual figure of the thoughtful, brooding, bald Secretary of State Montagu, sculpted by H.P. Tanya. Now, no such attention or empathy lies in store for the nationalist statues as they stand alone, ignored, and barely seen among the crowds and traffics of the congested city. Nor has there been any equivalent trend of scholarly or art historical interest in the form and style of these figures. In whom we have sculpted them, or in what occasioned their making and placement in these locations. Most telling is the way the identity of the sculptors who are commissioned to make these figures stand in complete and continuous erasure. The plaques of the plinth carry in most cases no more than the name and biographical detail of the person represented, but at times they're filled more with details of the dignitaries who were present at the unveiling of the function of the object, as can be seen in this plaque beneath the seated statue of Indrashagar at Curzon Park at Esplanade. Okay. Almost never is there a name to be read, recognized, and reckoned of the sculptor who produced the likeness. This information is the one that seems to be the least necessary and the most redundant in the public and official life of these objects. The same seems to be true of much of the commissioned public art that has come up in areas of Newtown, Rajarhat, some of them I think brought over from Durga Pujas, where the name of the maker is always absent. So here again, I know that it was inaugurated by Sholok Ganguly. I could not find out any more about who made it. This absence of the maker is what it most insistently shows up the failure of these objects to qualify as works of sculpture, even as they barely fulfill their commemorative duties towards the person they set out to immortalize. As the ceremonial purpose to which they were once made and put in the places they occupy fade from public memory, so retreats the aura of presence and personalities from these mute figures, hollowing out even their meaning as statues. Ritually fettered at every birth anniversary, nobody bothers thereafter to even remove the dried garlands that remain strung around them for the rest of the year. Okay. I do have a last section, but I think I will leave that out, and I'd rather have some questions and answers. So there was just a small section which was looking at, as I said, the work I really like to take over, which is the local history of statue making in the city. When I'm looking at this, the career of the postcolonial genre, which has always been written in terms of neglect, corruption, degeneration, or what was the fine art. And it's interesting that now art college students still go to the Victoria Memorial to study anatomy from the colonial figures. They still consider perfect works of anatomy. So I'm going to skip that out and just briefly end perhaps with the work of one figure, which is I'm going to jump to the 1930s, 40s, and 50s, when in these last years of empire, we have the first cast of India's local figures, Calcutta's local figures, made by local sculptors like Gopesh Chopra, actually being created. And 54 is of course post-independence. By that time, Gopesh Chopra is dead. So I'm looking at figures who are coming from backgrounds of Krishnanagar, trained in clay modeling, but who turned to sculpture making. And Gopesh Chopra is a figure I'd like to work further on. And I'd like to particularly show you this figure, which is one of the earliest ones we have of an Indian, Rajendranath Mukherjee, the pioneering entrepreneur. He sets up, he's one of the shareholders of Martinburg, and he today occupies a place in Victoria Memorial, the only Indian who stands there. And what he's holding in his hand is the drawing and the architectural layout of the memorial itself. It's quite a splendid piece, and it's again a work of Gopesh Chopra. I'd like to move quickly on to the work of Devi Prashad Rai Chaudhary, who's a well-known academic, realist sculptor, trained in the Government Art College, a student of Rabindranath Tagore, who then goes on to become vice principal of the Madras Art College, and has a fairly flourishing career as the official national sculptor of independent India. Now, in the 1930s and 40s, he gets his first two commissions. One is the figure of Ashutosh Mukherjee, which is lying in neglect, and another is fine piece of the early nationalist leader, Shirendranath Banerjee, which he completed in 1941. Now, there is a fascinating material history to be uncovered of the long travel and arduous transaction of objects and technologies that lie behind the making of statues like this. Both the figures made by Devi Prashad traveled as plaster of Paris models all the way to Italy to be cast in bronze and returned to Calcutta, with even the stone pedestal of the Shirendranath statue ordered and shipped from the sculpting studios of Italy. With the outbreak of the Second World War, the completed 11-foot bronze figure of Shirendranath, along with its 14-foot pedestal, remained trapped as enemy property in a captured Italian ship at the Calcutta docks, till the Calcutta Memorial Committee, that had spent over 30,000 on this commission, secured its release from the ship and had it erected in Esplanade's Curzon Park next to the Octogonal Monument. In Devi Prashad Shirendranath, we see the closest transposition of the poses and conventions of the Western sculptural genre, the figure's swagger, flowing coat and trousers, lending itself to the perfect replication of its colonial rivals. In its now forgotten enclosure in Curzon Park, now named Shirendranath Udyan after him, hidden behind the city's biggest bus depot, the statue holds its own as an example of the best of our early nationalist statuary against the latter-day standardized bronze figures of Vidyasagar or Derosio. Yet, for the sculptor, neither of these two early sculptural commissions met the measure of what he hoped to achieve, neither the Shirendranath piece nor Sir Ashutosh. It is later with his iconic bronze figure of Mahatma Gandhi on his Dandi March that he felt he had made his most satisfying public sculpture for the city. Executed over 2 years, completed in 1958, a decade after Gandhi's death, the sculptor had to finally take recourse to melting a bronze bust he had made of his own father to meet an acute shortage of metal in the city that year, to correct and repair on time the leg of Gandhi that had been damaged in the process of its lifting onto its pedestal. We're invited to think here of an effective flow of molten bronze from the figure of Devi Prashad's own father to that of the father of the nation, also from this original statue, carefully nurtured by its maker, to the replicas that would travel to other cities like Madras. In the 1950s, Devi Prashad Gandhi takes its canonical place with his other monumental public sculptural works, like the Martyrs' Memorial or the Triumph of Labour, that came to be placed in New Delhi, to produce an official social realist iconography for the new nation. Dislodging Foley's sculpture of General Outram, which stood for 84 years at the Pastry Chorambi crossing, the erection in this prime location of the city's first statue of Gandhi, on which the government had invested no less than 60,000 rupees, with Prime Minister Nehru presiding over its opening, marks a key moment in the history of Calcutta's post-colonial statuary. And I'll end with this because I just wanted this piece up, because I think in a way it marks the high point, and from there, yes, there will be many. Today we have copies of Devi Prashad Gandhi in various other locations in the city, but I think I'll end here. Thank you.
Welcome to questions, and Lenny?
I think this is really wonderful.
in Calcutta and going India numerous times. I just have a few observations, trying to make it very brief. I think that you should correlate this, these statues and the fate of them with the changing of street names, because that goes along with the moving of the statues. It's the changing of the names of Lansdowne Road and all the other roads that have changed to Indian names. Of course, Netaji, who has a certain place in my life and a certain place in Calcutta, although you confine yourself to Calcutta, I think it is useful to ask yourself which Bengalis, if any, are represented outside of Bengal. And I think that Vivekananda and Netaji seem to be the only ones.
And maybe Tagore.
And there was no Tagore that you showed here.
Yeah. The first Tagores begin to come up in 61. So yes, there's no Tagore in his lifetime, of course. It's Tagore centenary, 61.
Yes.
And the Rabindra Shravan, I think, is one of the earliest ones. Yes. I have a horror story to tell of Tagore statues.
That
would be another thing.
Yeah, just let me say that I believe that when this was put up, maybe Parto will correct me, that it was attacked. And they had to put up a barbed wire around the statue.
In 58?
Later. Do you?
No, this was because of the fear that, you know, this is the whole Nazarite.
Yes.
Attacks on national statues.
Yes.
A lot of these statues were in fact.
But the Gandhi one was pointed out to me as the one that's a particular animus.
Okay.
So is there any indica? So you say there were others as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, what was interesting is that when I was shifting, of course, Devi Prasad's work belonged to that cusp of independence and nationalism when he's commissioned to do the works of, yes, figures like Shurendranath Banerjee, Ashutosh Mukherjee, and later the Gandhi Commission. And I think this is one of the country's first officially commissioned Gandhi statues after 48. Now, one would have thought that the 50s is precisely when all colonial statuary would be leaving the city to be replaced by new statues. But they don't. Actually, in Calcutta, they continue to be in place through the 60s. One of the things that I'd hope to show, but I would certainly like to work on, is two very interesting film representations we have from the 1960s when the colonial statues are still in place. So the one reference I make is to a Satyajit Ray film called Porosh Pathor. What is its English?
The Philosopher's Stone.
Where it is the story of this clerk who finds this magic stone and imagines. And one of his is he's going on a ride in a car and all the colonial period statues are in place. And then he becomes a statue himself. So this is where he suddenly feels that the colonial statue had been replaced by him and he's become the great person. So it's interesting that in the 60s, so it is really, as I said, in 67 to 69, 70, at the height of the Naxal movement, that for fear of a very different kind of vandalism, that the statues are quickly removed. So Jyoti Chakraborty of the PWD played a very important role in that. And they were quickly moved. So ones which were in the Victoria Memorial had already begun moving, the rest were moved, but that's when they moved to Bharatpur. Now what's interesting is that the Naxalites' real object was of course the Bengal Renaissance leaders much more than the colonial leaders. So the one statue to be vandalized was Vidyasagar in College Square, his head went rolling. But I think the colonial statues survived, but they were quickly moved. So that's the story I would like to work a bit on, partly on what is the politics that demand their dislocation at that moment, 20 years after independence. And also then it is on the left front that you have the first, you know, all the ones I showed of Khuriram and Shuja Sen are all coming up in the early years of the left front. So that, and also the fact that in post-colonial period, statues, the The community small busts are all erected by public subscription, by political clubs, but none of the big ones are all state-sponsored. But in the colonial period, they were all raised by public subscription. So that's also interesting. It becomes a much more official and status project in terms of filling. And I think it continues to be that in different cities.
Is there a convention that figures of state, so Sierra's mayors and viceroys, but chief ministers and so on, that they, unlike say the activists, or of course the football player and so on, they must be absolutely still. That mobility is undignified. Because, I mean, it was you couldn't help noticing in this array of things you showed that stillness seems to go with being a figure of state. None of them move, none of them had any mobility, they're all sedentary. And so I was wondering if there's some.
And
but Gandhi's the activist. He never accepted the state of state, right? So that's, in fact, a rather interesting and vivid case of the point. And I think also, this may be just an instinctive observation on my part, but if you look at portraits and sort of kings in the Western tradition, they tend to be completely immobile. It's just part of what it is to be dignified or attached to the state. I'm curious about whether an implicit convention
Of course, you know, the quality of, you know, stillness or of being frozen in a certain posture, of course, that is the essence of being a statue, right? So when in jewelry you would play a statue, it was about this perfect freeze, but in a particular pose. So if the pose could be in motion, but you freeze that motion. Now, Gandhi's is a classic instance of that frozen in motion pose, because it's always Gandhi marching, but I did not have time for that. But I do have a section at the end where we have a modernist sculptor visiting these statues and criticizing this Gandhi. Gandhi's forbade saying, Gandhi lacks movement. He's saying, where is the legendary gait of the Mahatma with Gandhi march? He's being frozen. And so Ramkirpal has his own Gandhi, which he sculpts. I just show you the image. I mean, his sculptures have a different mobility. These are the two Ramkirpal pieces. Now, and of course, his Santal figures are tremendous. And even though he works with cement and concrete, he's able to bring life and mobility. But I am trying to argue that regardless of whether they are great figures of state or whether they are more popular, agitational figures of movements, in becoming statues, they necessarily become not inanimate, where their commemorative functions become important. And I think this question of being stilled and frozen into this embodied person, and one of the paradoxes that interests me, therefore, is that how this person would then reside in what is precisely being made this dead inanimate object. And you have so many stories, and I'm reminded of Oscar Wilde's particularly, where you ultimately think of a beating heart within the statue. And the idea that originally, very often, they were living persons from which death marks. So there's something of the trace of the living. The ones living, but increasingly statues get to be emptied out. And if you now look at the whole repeating cast, even representational similitude can be thrown away. I mean, they need to become cognizable as a figure. And so that you don't even need anatomical likeness, similitude, any of this. So there is a way in which there's a routineness, there's almost a template that can keep it. So I would say that the stillness remains, regardless of, yes, but it's interesting how even the football, you know, is of course has to be shown mobile. But what I'm thinking about is the freezing posture.
No, that's, I mean, of course, the freezing posture is maybe built into the form, but, you know, the art form, but I'm just Secretary of Culture is highly mobile, Mr. But he's a general. So I'm really thinking that this is a distinction between the professional and the...
Well, Uttrup seemed to be one of the finest examples, precisely because it is about the horse, which is, and that movement. And if you look at the Jyotingas on the horse where he's traveled and that, you realize how even the art of equestrian statuary is not natural. So you're like putting somebody in a dhoti on a horse, looking awkward, but nonetheless wanting to do that. But there's something I'll think about. Perhaps there is something about mobility in different genres, but also interesting when you go into the more popular variants, they become colored. So there's a different notion of animation with the small bust. And most recently, Calcutta has had a Mother Teresa fully colored, and with her canonization, she's almost like a wax idol. So that's again interesting, right? That somewhere with sainthood, she's like a worshipped image. So,
A couple of questions. Very, at least that come to mind when I think about how Calcutta is born. Longest lasting elected communist government on the planet. How did that impact?
What statue building?
Yeah.
Interesting question. The early period of the Left Front is when a lot of the revolutionary leaders, which I showed, there were less Gandhis. So for instance, these Bengali revolutionary, particularly the Khudiram and the Chudash, in very, very prominent places along that. Along with Madhav Giri Hazra, which were very much agitational leaders. So those, that kind of revolutionary past of a Bengal tradition was being revived. But I must say, compared to the regimes that we are now surrounded by, whether Modi's or Jayalalitha's or Mamata Banerjee's, there's a whole premium on iconicity of the leader, which I don't think the Left Front was invested in the same way. So in some sense, we don't have a single statue of Jyoti Basu in the city. And probably we will not have. We will not have. In fact, the old man I showed, I initially thought was Jyoti Basu, it's not. You know, the man just sitting there, he could have been, he just very dhoti and sprung much. So that's again interesting that we've not had a canonization of. And there was, I would say there was a deep suspicion of the icon in Left politics. And I think Jyoti Basu belonged to that generation of left politics, which I think his most iconic picture is one where Raghu is seen when he's addressing a rally and those kinds. But there was no investment in the image, I would say. Late CPM, yes, but not so much. So I would say there's been a huge bounty of statue building under the current chief minister, on which I have a whole paper to write. She's even made a wax museum in Calcutta where she features as among the main. So interestingly, she's not made a statue of herself, but she's made her way into something called the Mother's Wax Museum, where there's a lot of them and she features. So Mother Teresa, she wears her white and blue sari. You're wondering, she's taking on all kinds of personalities. She's Durga, she's Mother Teresa. Now there's a whole politics of image making and iconicity unfolding. And I've been telling various people that I think now those who study politics need to look much more closely at this, the rhetoric of the image and what it's doing.
Who determines the past? Is it, it's obviously a political past. Doesn't PWD or some other party, is it a state agency or a central agency? Or a city agency that determines?
I would say a city agency, the PWD, the Public Works Department and Capital Corporation. Kolkata Corporation would play an important role. So the government in power, yes. The public subscription ones happen, but seldom could you find. So, you know, I would say the Naxalite leader was such a rare thing to find. I was really surprised to see. Or maybe Parthala can tell me something. I would say that was so offbeat. So yes, I think even in the small clubs where local, you know, patrons may become, I think the question of state power has been absolutely critical in terms of sponsorship of this thing. But with a lot of the Dalit politics, of course, there have been a lot of community investment in the Ambedkar past and now in a series of other kinds. But I think from a lot of the official commemorative statues, state power is absolutely essential in terms of commissioning. But it comes within the city municipalities. I don't think it really, there's no long chain that takes you up to Delhi.
Thank you for this very fascinating talk. And there's lots I want to discuss with you later about the aura, about this suspended animation, about an aesthetics of alienation, willful alienation. But I want to go back to the question of mobility and try to think about what kind of circulations are assumed by within this location, since this is Calcutta, and Calcutta's public statuary. And I'm thinking about the way you introduced the slides by saying, this is a traffic gaze, right? It necessitates a particular distance, which is not contingent, non-identification. And I'm thinking back to a recent paper I wrote by Kaji Jen, where she talks about the connection between traffic and a new form of public statuary, which is basically huge statues of gods. And those statues often funded by cement manufacturing companies, predicated on a kind of suburban traffic for a particular demographic. And clearly this is a very different kind of a case. So I'm just thinking about what kinds of publics are imagined and constituted by a particular kind of public statuary in terms of this mobile and distracted gaze.
Now, contributes a powerful argument about mobile spectatorship, particularly not just the large religious monumental statuary, but even with the Ambedkarite monuments, and the fact that, you know, the politics of monumentality and scale becomes important. Now, she does say that, and the fact that these are designed to bring large publics in, rallies which will come in, and therefore the spaces are for mass gatherings. You know, so she lays them out. So like the Lincoln Memorial, they're very large spaces. So I would say there's a very different project of bringing publics in and a public spectatorship and the performative work that this statue will be doing. I would be reluctant to think of a similar purpose and intent with a lot of this. Because these are routinely set up, they're officially commemorative. Sometimes it's about street names. So yes, it may match a heart. Nobody even knows he exists behind those trees. It's not a man's statue, but the name, it's called Meghnasha Sharani, although Uttam Kumar won there. But very often it's that, but they're set up. But I would say that they're not, while they are obviously objects of moving spectatorship, you pass them by, there's an immediate cognitive value they would have. I don't think they're serving the same function. Where these other statuary, if you look at monumental statuary on the highways are one thing, but a lot of the Ambedkar Parivartan Sthal, which she worked on, all this huge Noida Park, are places which are designed to bring in publics. So they're in the outskirts of the city and they're about rallying and bringing in publics. So I would say, I would think of very different logics of publics and spectatorship. And here I'm working with the idea that they remain fairly ignored objects, which is why it has become hard to work on public civics, actually, that unless they are politically charged, unless they're carrying a particular intention of symbolic politics, it's very hard to draw them out of that space of disinterest.
With regard to the left-front government and the state, if there weren't any statues of Jyotibas, were there any of Marx, Lenin, or Stalin put up in that list instead?
No Stalin. I don't know whether Calcutta ever had Stalin. Lenin, yes. Marx, yes. And Marx still exists. One of the few places where Marx statue would still exist, of course, in Berlin, you've kept part of the Marx statue. Yes, Lenin, very interesting story. It's a Soviet gift. So when, for instance, I was pursuing the Surendranath statue in this bus depot, which is now a very crowded place. It's called the Surendranath Vidya, and it had a landscape of statues. And I was searching out. The bus depot, one of the drivers said, and it's an anecdote, but it's a very telling anecdote, saying, nobody cares for these sculptures. Nobody cares. The British left. The Indian leaders are here, but nobody cares for these sculptures. You've come to look at them. I'm really surprised. He knew where exactly every sculpture was. And he said, there's only one Bideshi whose sculpture is still here, and look how gleaming and how beautifully he's maintained. So I said, but which sculpture would have remained? And he pointed to the Lenin statue. So that's the Bideshi who remains. There are other Bideshi, so Lenin is there, but there isn't a plethora of it. There's a Ho Chi Minh, which was gifted, so you have a Ho Chi Minh ceremony. So you have Ho Chi Minh, you have a Lenin in precisely where Lenin suddenly began in Dharamtala. Again, not to be seen very much. So yes, I would say that the left front's investment, as I would say, even in Soviet socialist style, giant Marxists and Lenins were not there. In some sense, it's the Devi Prashad's pieces that I show which bring Soviet socialist realist work into the space, which is the Triumph of Labor, Martyrs Memorial, kind of work. But the kind of investment in monumental socialist statuary that marks much of the landscape, you don't see in that.
This is perhaps not on the subject at all, but some years ago, I went into the museum and I decided to go up to the left side, which is the natural history part. And there is a room, as there is here at the Natural History Museum, of large dioramas of the various peoples of India and their states. And the day I was there, I was in the room with about a dozen or so, seemed a family from UP, all dressed kind of jock peasant style at the time. And they were looking at the diorama of UP. And they're saying, oh, it's just like us. See, they're using the same things we use. They're using the same saman, same vartan, and so on. And they were delighted.
What would that do to anthropology?
I know. I was just thinking of the difference of their experience, maybe a rare one. This was not a monument. It was something that they could identify with. And of course, they were, in a sense, statues. They were built, you mentioned waxworks and mannequins.
Well,
that's
not very different. They have the animated effects completely because they're painted and they're given settings, elaborate settings in which they are meant to be. Well, statues are meant to be lifelike, and that is why I think the question of the lifelike needs to be seen across these different competing genres. And the fact that civic statuary almost decide to go bronze and marble and shed many of their other kind of colors, clothing, you know, is something I was thinking. But the dioramas would be very, very interesting, but I'm thinking, because one always thinks of the subject and his discomfort at seeing his image of diorama. Here you're saying, perhaps there's recognition, there's also some sense of us being, you know, so being in the museum, you could feel you become objectified, but you could also perhaps feel that somewhere a culture has been acknowledged. So perhaps there's something assertive about being there in the museum too. So that's an interesting story.
Would you mind passing me your diagonally backwards?
Thank you very, very much. I wanted to ask you, you talked a little bit towards the beginning about sort of tracing the circuits of movement that you see developing, and you mentioned London, Calcutta and London, and then also there was a really interesting, almost kind of an aside, you mentioned there was, I think, a sculpture of Auckland that went to Auckland in Australia. And so I was just wondering in New Zealand. So I was curious how broadly you kind of imagine tracking these circuits and and if we're thinking about the object flows of empire, sort of what, how you're thinking about empire, like whether it's sort of within, whether it might be across the British Empire, whether it be primarily between, say, India and Britain. Just curious.
Yeah, that's an important question because London becomes this kind of centralized depot where a lot of Italian, French sculptors come and they find a professional space filling up. And it's empire that greatly provides a huge market for statues. So which is where I think in a new body of work, you know, a study of figurative sculpture and not just in terms of the demands that London, Paris, or Rome would have for it, but in terms of feeding the demands of the empire came on. Most of what I've followed in terms of these travels and trackings have come out of existing writing. It's not really primary research that I've done. But I would say that in some sense, this, and I think this question came up earlier too, that very often chances are that since they were being shipped across, they would be coming to Bombay or they would be coming to Calcutta. And then they would be shipped or they would be moved to other cities where these statues were coming up. But I think certainly the, over the 19th century, Calcutta and London operate very closely. I've often wondered why you needed to transport gunmetal across, or the fact that there are bronze foundries in Calcutta, there's a lot of iron foundry, and yet all sculpture making happens in studios there. Why, when Devi Prashad is making his pieces too, there's a need to send them abroad. So you made the maquette and you needed to send them. So obviously there was a whole place, and which is where one, it was the expense of the material, and while it was being locally made, marble and bronze, it seems that a lot of the prestigious commissions were about, one, there were Royal Academy sculptors mostly getting them, but even when you have Indian sculptors getting the work, I was interested therefore in the material history on how it gets trapped in an enemy ship in war and then needs to be retrieved. So there seems to be amazingly complex histories of the travels of material. Early plaster casting histories, when the Sanchi stupa is cast, it seems that a whole ship arrives with a particular gel, which is then moved across to Sanchi, and then Henry Cole undertakes this huge casting operation. So I'm actually interested in how the making of casts and objects involve huge amounts of transportation of skills and material. Haven't done too much research on this yet, but it is something that interests me. And I think official documents can do a lot on this actual movements of material.
Tapati, I have a question, at least it will end up as a question. When you showed us Lord Conway's as a Roman, and mentioned that the head, you could see where the head had been added to it, it reminded me of the fact that in museums in Libya, we have a lot of what seem to be funerary sculptures, but all, mostly in a toga, but all, none of them have heads. And the local, the explanation I was given by people whose field is classical art is that a number of these statues were made, ready-made, and then all that the sculptor needed to do was to add the head of the individual to that sculpture. Do you think anything of that sort is at all possible in this? There are so many of the governor generals and then the viceroys, mostly the governor generals, who are in as Roman figures.
I think with Corpulus, it is so obvious. And I would not have noticed that thing. There was Alfred Drury, who's a very well-known Victorian sculptor, who does a lot of the friezes that went around the Victoria Memorial. His grandson works on figurative sculpture, and he gave me, I was meant to give him a tour of the Victoria Memorial, and I ended up learning a lot from him. He's the one who pointed and he said, this was very common. You just bought when you needed to have them look like, because I often wondered, how could Cornwallis have posed? And he said, there was no question of that. It's a ready-made body on which you put the head. So I think when you needed to produce them as Roman emperors, that fakeness notwithstanding, I think there's a different premium on realism by the time you have them fully working. So I think that moment of, I would say, that fake masquerade as Roman emperor, or even Hastings' toga and orientalist tableau, is perhaps a specific moment in the sculptural histories also of the genre. And the fact that there is huge demand for neoclassicism and for entering. Now, interestingly, I think that is where a different realist genre will take over. And I think that's worth tracking. The Cornwallis is almost a standalone piece. You do not see too many of them faking it out as Roman emperors, though there must be so much of it. But the fact that these casts, as you're saying, were heavily in demand in sculpting studios, you could get these copies. And then when you think of places like Marble Palace, where such figures are proliferating, right? These figures, neoclassical statuary. So sculpture studios are making a huge trade out of producing copies in marble, in plaster, in bronze to be transported. And then sometimes you could put a government in this head and have it there. So 1803 Cornwallis is said to be the first sculpted image to come all the way from England to Cornwall. So it kind of inaugurates with the 19th century, the British Empire's culture making history in the city, the statue making history. But the Libyans, so yes, maybe they were not, they were meant to have heads put on them, maybe they were not decapitated there, and you could put a face to match. I think they would do them for Vivekananda and all now. They would have a template, I'm sure, of this robe, and then in this case, you just turn the thing of the heads around. And I think you're absolutely right that the two figures that would have an All India repertoire is precisely the two who've taken over the streets of Calcutta. But I've seen Netajis of different kinds in Jaipur in places like that. But they're much more under canopies and very different kind of iconographies in the princely states.
Maybe we'll make up the last question.
Well, thank you very much, Tati.
This is meant to bring back memories of that portion where I last met with Chris.
Tati and I went to see the statues at Barrackpore, and luckily we got into the like South House, all very densely packed and hard to see amidst some of the foliage. I wanted to ask a question, bearing back to the more contemporary times, about this very fascinating three-year period, 67 to 69, I think you said, when the government, the communist government, moved all of the British statuary that do not exist in the Victoria Memorial area, but elsewhere, to Barrackpore. I wanted to ask, was there how much of it was a strategy of simply relocation? How much of it was a strategy of erasure, in the sense that was there a strategic idea of locating alternate statues in their places? Was there a logic, in some cases, of replacements? And were those replaced statues from a pre-existing bank of post-independence sculpture, or was there suddenly a burst of statuary making to replace those hidden spots?
Well, that's an interesting question, and I'm calling it a musical chair game because I don't think there's a logic in who replaces who, right? They're using the same pedestals, and they're certainly all commissioned, so there isn't like a reserve you have of statues waiting to find pedestals, no. I think there's a conscious attempt. I would say by the 60s, they had already, in a way, been erased from public memory, perhaps. Some of it remains. If you go around the Eden Gardens and the Maidan, you have some of the cenotaphs of the war soldiers, which are still in place, which were not removed. And today you have police cenotaphs, which copy, where you have the head lowered and the cap raised. Those remain. So in fact, there's some of the World War II kind of cenotaphs of martyred soldiers who remain. The ones in Victoria Memorial had already moved, some by 22. The others, I think some were relocated, including the one of Rajendranath Mukherjee used to be in Dalhousie, but when Martin Byrne, I think, closed up, they moved. It seemed to be a safe haven to keep statuary. And Barakpur, much later, was initially dumped, and I think 20 years after that, they got restored. The logic of that moving at that time, I think, will need to be studied more than it has. Why that specific moment, and whether there's the same logic operating in Delhi, they moved to Jubilee Park much earlier, because in the imperial capital, they have to empty out King's Way and Queen's Way, and you know the famous canopy where George stood had to be emptied. Calcutta is interesting because the corporation is taken over by the Congress. After the 30s, you have no colonial statuary. The George V is the last. And so there's a perhaps an early moment when already nationalist leaders are being commissioned, but by public subscription. I don't think there's a logic on who finds its way where. Otherwise, why would Canning be replaced by Chittaranjan Das? I don't think there's a logic there. But one could work out an interesting kind of game. The fact that even finding out who existed there, one needed to get an old manual on Calcutta statues, which told you who had existed there before. So one was able to read partly through old photographs, which shows many things in the town hall, but the fact that Canning was there and went. Lady Canning, as we know, was in Barakpur. I thought it's an interesting thing that rather than place Canning inside, they placed him next to his wife, which was an interesting move, which means even those who were relocated had some sense of where they belong. I thought it was an interesting affective move that, and Canning was always a popular, he was called, as you know, Clemency Canning, Lady Canning was an important. So he stands next to his wife's grave on the riverfront and the rest are there. So I do think that those, when they were moved, it was always said that Calcuttans treated their colonial statuary with far greater leniency and feeling than other language movements. And you often wonder why the language movement needed to deface the way. But it was also because of Bombay presidency and all that. But there's, so what happens to colonial period statuary? Some travel back, Hardinge goes back to England, Auckland may go back to, went to New Zealand. Bulk of them make their way to the backyards of museums. So you go to a lot of museums, you find at the back just relocated statues. It's what's happened in all the ex-Soviet places. You, what you do with your gigantic statues, most of them are there in what they call graveyard or statue parks. So I don't know. I think that's what happened. Now why, again, to ask your question, those 3 years, but I think that's roughly when they all moved. Calcutta's last statuary all moved. Certainly after the 70s, there are no statuary of any British ruler, which is on, well, in the Victorian Memorial, which is of course in the heart of the city, or in Barakpur. So it required, but I think in most other cities, they moved before.
Which makes it even more intriguing to see that in Bangalore, Queen Victoria still reigns in front of Covent Park. I mean, it's such a popular spot, and there she is. So it makes it even more interesting.
And in Bangalore, we know that the Covent Park activists all wanted to keep Victoria there. Now, Victoria's had a special place. Victoria exists in many Indian cities. She was our queen. She exists in many places. I don't think Victoria's have all been removed. There's a whole loving relationship with that. with which Victoria it was looked at. And what's interesting is, of course, as we know, that Curzon's Victoria Memorial is built here long after the capital moves. So there was a talk of having Victoria Memorial in Delhi. Curzon was absolutely determined to have it in Calcutta. And as you know, Calcutta has absorbed the memorial with great love and made it its own memorial. Of course, nobody bothers about the statue. In fact, even the curators of the Victoria Memorial cannot give you a tour of the statue. So when Julian Drury came, they found me as somebody working on statues. And much of what I've learned from Kolkata statues have come out of the visits of British scholars. So you had Richard Barnes coming, and I went with him to Barakpur, and he told me so much on these statues. So in fact, it's when British scholars come to Calcutta that I talk with them and I get to know more about them. They are interested in these statues, Calcuttans aren't. The art school students go to, as I said, they've been emptying of their colonial content. They've just become good examples of sculpture. So you go, you learn anatomy, and you can see them. So you know, who even remembers who? I don't know how many people in Calcutta will even remember who Uttram is. Even history students will not have any meaning for that Uttram sculpture there. So Victoria, yes, it's that identifiable figure. Most of them have been emptied of their personhood in terms of who they would have been. So it's really the British scholar who comes in search of this. So the first time I got to know about Uttram was when you had somebody making a documentary on Henry Fooley, and they made me stand in front of that sculptor and say a few things, and I was so amazed. But you know, it was to search it out in the Victoria Memorial was important.
Tapati, we can't wait for your future research on this subject and look forward to the time you come back and give us much more on the subject. Thank you so much.